In this lecture video, we're going to go over equilibrium problem solving for weak acids. Typically, a problem might ask you to solve for the pH after a weak acid dissociates in water. And what visually is going on is that you start with the weak acid HA, and when it reaches equilibrium in water, most of that acid will remain intact. But some of it would have dissociated to form hydronium ions and its conjugate base A minus in equal 1-to-1 ratios. So the picture of that equilibrium solution might look something like this, where HA, shown in green, is the dominant species, but you have some amounts, small but equal amounts, of hydronium ion and the conjugate base. So these problems, basically, we're looking to solve for the concentration of hydronium ions and then plugging that in to compute pH. In this specific problem, we're going to calculate the pH of a 0.05 molar solution of acetic acid. Acetic acid is shown here. It is a carboxylic acid, so it is a weak acid. And you probably better know this molecule as vinegar. And it dissociates in water with the Ka value shown here. If we have initially an HA naught concentration, then at equilibrium, that's just equal to the initial concentration minus the change variable X. And X is going to depend on the value of Ka. And here, Ka is very small, so we would expect X to also be a small number. HA naught is relatively much larger than the Ka value, then at equilibrium, we approximately have, within significant error, the same concentration at initial time. With those assumptions in place, I can start this problem by making my ICE table, where I is initial concentration, C is change, and E is equilibrium concentration. At initial time, here's my starting concentration of the weak acid. And in my product side, I have zero of its conjugate base. And I basically have zero amounts of hydronium ion. Technically, because water can self-dissociate, we do have some hydronium ion in pH 7 water, 1 times 10 to the minus 7, but this is such a small amount that we can basically disregard it in this problem. So with respect to change, because we only have reactants, we can only move forward, so that's minus X for the weak acid, and all these coefficients are 1, so plus X for the two products. And I can sum these first two rows to get expressions for the equilibrium concentrations. We expect the change to be also a very small value. And if X is small relative to the initial amount of the weak acid, then we can say that at equilibrium, that concentration is roughly the same as the initial amount. And then just like before, we can use the equilibrium constant expression. And in this case, this will be Ka. And this is a ratio of the hydronium ion and the conjugate base over the acid. And that's equal to the 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5. Now we are solving for the pH of the solution. And pH, if you recall, it's just the minus log of the concentration of the hydronium ions. So this is just like our equilibrium problems before, where we solve for X, and then we do an extra step here where we convert X, or the concentration of hydronium ion, into pH using this equality. I can go ahead and plug in the equilibrium concentrations. That's X squared in the numerator, and 0.05 in the denominator, and that's equal to the Ka value. This becomes pretty straightforward to solve for x, and I get that indeed it is a very small number. It's 9.5 times 10 to the minus 4. Basically, I'm solving for minus log of x in order to get the pH value. So I can plug in the x. When you take the log of a number, the sigfigs are actually all contained here. The magnitude is not considered a significant figure. So when we take the log of 9.5 times 10 to the minus 4 and multiply that by minus 1, we get 3.02, where basically this first number 3 is a reflection of the magnitude, and 0.02 that matches the number of sigfigs in the original value of 9.5 times 10 to the minus 4. So we arrive at our answer, in which the pH of this weak acid solution is actually fairly acidic at 3.02. In the second part of this problem, we can address another type of question, which basically asks, what is the percent dissociation of a weak acid in water? So the percent dissociation is simply what percentage of the initial acetic acid actually becomes dissociated to form the products, hydronium ion and its conjugate base A minus. So we can think of dissociation as being a ratio of the concentration of the conjugate base over the initial concentration of the weak acid. And because this is a percent dissociation, we have 100 multiplied to this ratio. So we've already figured out before that both the concentrations of hydronium ion and A minus are 9.5 times 10 to the minus 4. So we can plug that in for the concentration of the conjugate base divided by the initial amount of the acetic acid times 100. And we would get that it's 1.9. So this image cartoon that we showed earlier actually should only reflect that less than 2% of the acetic acid will dissociate in water. And that means over 98% of the acetic acid actually remains intact in solution. As we do these equilibrium problems, do keep in mind what is a strong versus a weak acid. If it's a strong acid, then the dissociation will be 100% and you won't need to use an ICE table. So for instance, if I had asked for the pH of a 0.05 molar HCl solution, then you would know that this is a strong acid and that it fully dissociates, meaning this reactant will react all the way down to zero. And on the product side, we will get out exactly 0.05 molar of hydronium ions, which we can then plug into the pH expression. But for weak acid, the percent dissociation depends on Ka and the initial concentration of the weak acid, because both of these factors are important in determining how far the reaction proceeds. And because it's in equilibrium and it's not complete, we do need to use an ICE table to solve for X and then the pH of the solution. So one thing that's an interesting fact is that if you decrease the concentration initially of the weak acid, you actually increase the percent dissociation. So this sounds kind of strange. Why do you have more percent dissociation if you start with less weak acid? The concentration for a more dilute solution will be smaller than for a higher concentration. However, remember percent dissociation is a ratio of the conjugate base to the initial amount of the weak acid. So the percent dissociation can actually be larger. And another way to think about this in terms of Le Chatelier's principle is that when you have a low concentration of acid, you essentially have more volume for the acid to dissociate into. And so the percent dissociation will be larger for these more dilute solutions, even though the absolute concentration is smaller. In this next problem, we'll solve for another equilibrium weak acid dissociation, but now for a polyprotic acid. So in this example, I've chosen oxalic acid, which is diprotic, meaning it has two ionizable protons. So this is oxalic acid. It kind of looks like two carboxylic acids that are joined together. So this is also weak acid. And we're asked to solve for the pH of a 0.200 molar solution. So since we start with the neutral acid, the first dissociation then would be Ka1, which has this value, 5.6 times 10 to the minus 2. And we can populate the ICE table with the initial concentration. And because we only have reactants, this reaction moves forward or right to the products. And so we can write the change as minus X for oxalic acid and plus X for the two products. And then finally, I can sum over the initial plus change to get these equilibrium expressions here. Now you'll notice that oxalic acid has a pretty high value for Ka1. It's 10 to the minus 2, and the concentration initially of oxalic acid is on the order of 10 to the minus 1. So here you can see the difference between these two values isn't very large, which means that X is not going to be small, but rather a very significant number relative to 0.2. Next, we'll write the Ka expression shown here. And as before, we'll be solving for X, the hydronium ion concentration, and plugging that into this pH relationship to ultimately get the pH of the solution. So plugging in the equilibrium values into the Ka1 expression, I have x squared in the numerator over 0.200 minus x, and that's equal to Ka1 value. At this point, I do need the quadratic formula to solve for x, and I'm going to skip over those steps. So you'll have to take my word for it that if you rearrange this equation and then use the quadratic formula, you'll get out that the value of x should be 0.081. Indeed, quite a significant number relative to the initial concentration. So x now we can plug into the minus log expression. And like before, we would solve for pH by taking the minus log of 8.1 times 10 to the minus 2, and that gives us 1.09. Next, we're asked to determine the equilibrium concentrations of the three different states of oxalic acid in its neutral form, as the monoanion, and finally as the dianion. So in our initial ICE table, we had the neutral acid and the monoanion, and we had these equilibrium expressions. So now we can simply plug in our value for X, and we get that at equilibrium, the neutral acid is 0.119 molar, and at equilibrium, the monoanion conjugate base is 0.081 molar. So that leaves us with, what about the dianion, where all the protons are gone? Because that doesn't appear in Ka1, but it does appear in Ka2. To get the concentration of the dianion C2O4, we have to look at the Ca2 reaction, which is shown here. So now the weak acid in the Ca2 expression is the monoanion HC2O4, and in water we dissociate to form more hydronium ions and the dianion. Coming out of the Ca1 equilibrium, we have that the concentration of the monoanion and hydronium ion are both 0.081 molar, and we have none of the dianion yet. So Ca2 is actually a really small number, and so we would expect the change to be very small in this reaction, but because we don't have any of the dianion, this reaction has to move to the right to build in a little bit of this product. So to avoid confusion, the variable for change, I'm going to use Y since we had already used X for Ka1, and because this reaction moves forward or to the right, this would be minus Y for the reactants and plus Y for the two products. And by summing these two rows, I get these expressions for their concentration at equilibrium. So it is safe at this point to assume that this change is very small. And that's because if you look at Ca2, this is about 10 to the minus 5. And if you look at the initial weak acid concentration, it's about 10 to the minus 1. So almost 4 orders of magnitude different between these two values. And so 0.081 minus y is approximately equal to 0.081, and that's also true on the product side for the hydronium ion. As before, we would use the Ka expression, but now this is Ka2. So here are the products over the weak acid in Ka2, and I can plug in these values in the numerator, 0.081 times y divided by the concentration of the weak acid, which is also 0.081. So that gives me a pretty simple solution that y is equal to 5.4 times 10 to the minus 5, and this is then the concentration of the dianion that I was looking for. As expected, we do get a very small value for the concentration of this dianion that is formed. To summarize this polyprotic acid problem, we initially started with 0.2 molar of the neutral oxalic acid. And as a starting point then, this oxalic acid can engage in the Ka1 reaction to form its conjugate base, the monoanion. Once we do form significant amounts of the monoanion, it can itself dissociate in the Ca2 reaction to form its conjugate base, or the dianion. Now, these Ka values and the initial concentration of oxalic acid would suggest that the change in Ka1 reaction is very significant, but the change in the Ka2 reaction is very small. When we looked at the equilibrium concentration for these three molecules, indeed we see that these concentrations are much larger than the concentration of the dianion. What this all means is that a polyprotic acid can exist in solution with its conjugate base, but also the conjugate base that follows after another proton is ionized. But even though these three states can all coexist, there only one of these pairs can really dominate. And that's because these equilibrium values are so different that we wouldn't expect them to compete with each other, but rather that one of these would be dominant and the other would be occurring to a much smaller degree. So in this problem here, Ka1 is the dominant equilibrium, and that means the oxalic acid and the monoanion conjugate base are the dominant species at equilibrium. But if you look at the very small amounts of dianion in solution, it's also present.